सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यंकरवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शांति 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 Offering a collective pranams at the lotus feet of Sadhguru Shri Madhusudan Sai, who is our mentor and the founder of the Sri Satya Sai University for Human Excellence. To the respected leadership board members, staff and students, and my dear sisters and brothers, a loving Sairam and a hearty welcome to all. It's an honor, sir, to have you here today to address this August gathering. A hearty welcome to you. I am Anaga, pursuing my final year in the Bachelor's of Vedic Studies, which is in fact a course introduced in our university to teach us about the Vedantic truths and its philosophies, which correlates to our topic today, a Vedantic roadmap for a meaningful life. For the benefit of our audience, Nitin Sridhar sir is an author, speaker, and journalist based in Mysuru, India. Sir has a degree in civil engineering, and having worked in the construction field, he passionately writes about various issues from development, politics, and social issues to religion, spirituality, and ecology. He is currently editor of India Facts, which is a portal on Indian history and culture. Sir is the chief curator of Advaita Vedanta Academy, dedicated to the dissemination of Advaita Vedanta. His first book, Musings on Hinduism, provided an overview of various aspects of Hindu philosophy and society. His latest book, Samanya Dharma, enunciates upon general tenets of ethics as available in Hindu texts. However, his most widely read book is Menstruation Across Cultures, a Historical Perspective that examines notions and practices prevalent in different cultures and religions from across the world. It's a great fortune, sir, to have you here today to speak to us in this Words of Wisdom session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Nagaji, for inviting me. I just want to clarify that I'm no longer editor of India Facts. I'm now full-time with Advaita Academy, Indika Moksha. Anyways, so thank you very much for inviting me to address the young students. I'm always very happy to address the students of colleges, schools, etc. Because I believe it is very important to guide the youngsters, to provide them some form of guidance, some form of advice, so that they can make more informed choices. Something our generation did not have, especially in what matters related to dharma, culture, religious practice, etc. I hope I am clearly audible to everyone. So I'm assuming that I'm audible to everyone. Let me begin with a small prayer before starting my session. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha, Sada Shiva Samarambham, Shankaracharya Madhyamam, Asmadacharya Paryantam, Vande Guru Paramparam, Ishwaro Guru Ratmeti, Murti Bheda Vibhagini, Vyoma Vyapta Dehaya, Shri Dakshina Murtaye Namaha Bharati Karuna Patram Bharati Pada Bhushanam Bharati Pada Marudam Bharati Deetam Ashraye Vidya Vinaya Sampannam Vitaragam Vivekinam Vande Vedanta Tattvajnam Vidushekara Bharati Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om. So the topic for today's session is a Vedantic map, a roadmap for a meaningful life. So it's a very, the title itself is filled with very, very, very deep jargons with deep meanings. But let me first begin with asking the question, what constitutes a meaningful life? Because of course, we all want to lead a meaningful life. And we want to find meaning because without it, life becomes nirasa, as we say, without any juice in it. So what is it? What can we consider as meaningful life? So that is the first question. But let me begin with a more basic question. What do we all of us, what do we want in life? I mean, I'm seeing at least 100 people from different places on my screen. And I can say that answers that each one of you will give may be very different. I mean, they may be similar, but they will be definitely different, because each of us have a different aspirations in life. If I off the hand ask you, what makes you, what is the one thing what that you want? Some may say, I want to enter army. Or some may say, I want to become a doctor. Some may say, I want to get married. Or some may say, I want to find love in life. Some may say, I want to make a lot of money, career, so many things. But let us stop here. The point is, when I ask this question, what one wants in life, we all list our desires. We want a big house, big car, family, children, a good career, good money, good luxurious life. Some may say, even say that I want to make spiritual progress, I want to attain Siddhi. Material or spiritual, whatever it is, we have certain desires, certain goals that we want to pursue. But if we stop a second and analyze these various desires or goals that we want to pursue, we realize that what we actually want to pursue is happiness. Because it is because we believe that these are the things that can give us happiness, we want to pursue this. That is, I want to feel happy that I have a big house. I want to attain happiness in having a luxurious life or in a comfortable life, or I want to seek happiness through companionship with family members. So whatever it is, actual thing that we are perceiving is happiness. And this is very logical. If we simply think through this, everyone will have to come to this conclusion that everyone wants to be happy and nobody wants to be sad. It's a different issue that life is always full of happiness and sorrow. In our day-to-day life, if we are happy this moment, then within a few minutes later, we could be sad. We may hear some bad news and or get scolded in the school or college and we become sad. So happiness and sorrow always comes in life. But all of us want deeply is that to be always happy. Permanent happiness without any trace of sorrow. This is the goal that we all want. So we can say that this is perhaps the ultimate goal of life. Ultimately, this is what we all are pursuing in our own ways, whether we directly understand this or not. So when we say that we are finding meaning, we want to lead a meaningful life, then it implies that we want to lead a happy life. An unhappy life cannot be meaningful life. The key here is to understand what truly brings happiness. And that is where the whole philosophy, all darshanas, all the revelations of the rishis, of the shastras come into the picture. Now, since you are all students of Satya Sai University, I am assuming that you are all familiar with basic fundamental Hindu frameworks such as Purusharthas. So we just discussed certain goals and desires we pursue. So all of them can be categorized into four categories called Purushartha. Purushartha means Purusha Artha, the goals, the meanings, the in life a person pursues. Dharma, Artha, Kama, and Moksha. I'm not going to explain all of them. That is not the purpose of this talk. But briefly saying, all our mundane pleasures, all our material pleasures can be categorized under Kama, all the material comforts, the security, the financial security, even otherwise, you know, the food, clothing, shelter, all these basic necessities, they come under Artha, richness, wealth, everything comes under Artha, power. And then, of course, the ethical aspects of life is Dharma, but Dharma is more than that. I will, if time permits, I will definitely explain more. Dharma is the link between the material pleasures and comforts and wealth, etc., and the spiritual, which is the final goal, moksha. So in the Hindu conception of life, moksha is the ultimate goal, final goal of life, they say, the Shastras. But what does it mean when we say moksha is the ultimate goal? What is the definition of moksha? There are different ways to define moksha, understand moksha. And one simple definition is that it is a state. Of course, the Vedanta will say at an advanced level that moksha is not a state. It is our reality. But for our purpose, let us keep that aside. We are in this transactional universe. And from our perspective, moksha can be understood as a state of permanent happiness, devoid of any trace of sorrow. So we just discussed a while back how in our day-to-day life, happiness and sorrow always come. Pleasure and pain always come together. You enjoy some pleasure now, then you will have to ready yourself to face the pain. Just one example. You like some person. If they also like you back, then you feel pleasure. If they don't like you back, then you feel frustration, you feel pain. And such thing can be even simple as ice cream. You like an ice cream, but somehow when you go to get it, the ice cream has exhausted, the shop has exhausted the ice creams, and there are no shops assuming the whole locality. So then you feel sad that I could not eat ice cream. So whenever a desire is not, you are not able to fulfill a desire, it leads to sorrow. But even when you are able to fulfill the desire, even then the pleasure will last for only few minutes, few seconds, few days at max. So that is how the everyday world is there. The happiness is temporary, so also sorrow. But we are defining the ultimate goal of life, moksha, as permanent happiness without any sorrow. So that is one definition. So now, what is the Vedantic definition? Vedanta accepts this definition, but then it adds, it adds what exactly constitutes this moksha. Usually, when we speak about a roadmap, we start from a starting point A and then define the roadmap to reach the end point B, and with hundreds of midpoint. But in today's session, I will start with the end point, the goal, the moksha B, and go in the reverse direction and finally come to A. So please bear with me, and there is a reason why it is to be done. Because if I start in the conventional manner A to B, then you will lose sight of the goal. So I will start with the goal. And that goal is moksha, permanent happiness devoid of all kinds of sorrow. But what does it mean to attain that permanent happiness? How can we attain that permanent happiness? What constitutes it? What is the definition of it? I mean, saying permanent happiness is not same as attaining permanent happiness, right? So now, Vedanta defines. When I say Vedanta, what is Vedanta? Veda Anta, the end, the culmination, the zenith, the crown, the juice, the essence of Veda is Vedanta. It is basically a reference to the Upanishads, the teachings of the Upanishads, the knowledge revealed by the Upanishads. So the Veda is, by definition, Veda means knowledge. And the Veda constitutes of Samhita, Brahmana, Aranyaka, and Upanishadic portions. Also classified as Karmakanda, Jnanakanda. Please bear with me. I am specifically, deliberately using Sanskrit words at many places. And you can note these Sanskrit words down if you want, so that you can later check upon it and read more upon. So now, the twofold teachings of the Veda. Veda means knowledge. So it gives, if we have to condense the Veda into just two teachings, two most important teachings that it gives. This, the first is Dharma. The second is Jnana, the ultimate knowledge, Jnana. And this ultimate knowledge or Jnana is called as Vedanta, the zenith, the crown, the essence. And what is this Jnana? What knowledge is it speaking about? It is Brahma Atma Aikya Jnana, the knowledge of the identity and non-difference between Atman, that is my true self, and Brahman, which is Bhagavan, Ishvara, Nirguna Nirakara Brahma. This is what Upanishad says. Now again, for the paucity of time, I cannot go into detail about how this identity comes, because in our everyday life, we see that I am different from you. Forget Ishvara. Each of us are different from each other. Right? My thoughts are different. My ambitions are different. My temperament is different. There is so much difference when we speak about, there is a difference in terms of gender, there's difference in terms of height, in terms of age, in terms of social background we have, in terms of cultural background, we have so many differences are there. So this is in our case. Then there is of course difference between me and Ishvara. I am just a person with a name, form, etc. I have one identity. I was born in this this year. I will die someday in future. But Ishvara is none of this. Ishvara is the cause of the universe, is Jagat Karanam. He does not have a beginning, does not have an end. He is Nitya, he is eternal, Anadi, Ananta, right? So how is it that Vedanta equates between them? So that knowledge the Shastras reveal is the liberating knowledge. It is what gives us moksha. What is another definition of moksha? A simple, very everyday definition that we all will be aware of is liberation from the cycle of birth and death. Liberation from the freedom from the karmic cycle. So this karmic cycle, or the cycle of birth and death, it is happening because we are in the samsara. Right? That is why there is temporary happiness, temporary sorrow. Because we recognize that there is a difference, because we are in a condition wherein we see that I am separate from Ishvara, I am separate from Jagat, which includes all other people other than myself. So we all have this I-ness, I-identification, Ahankara, right? Ahankara and Mamahkara. That is, I am this. For example, I am Nitin Sridhar, I am an author, I am a speaker, I am a civil engineer, I am a chief curator. This is my body, Mamakar. I mean, this is my body, this is my house, this is my car, these are my family members, these are my children, right? Ahankara, Mamakara, I-ness and mine-ness. This is I, these belong to me. These are all mine. Because of this, we differentiate between I on one hand, Ishvara on the other hand, and Jagat, the world, on the other hand. Now the Vedanta, the Upanishad, the Shruti, it says that this distinction is a result of ignorance, avidya, or ignorance about the true nature of self, true nature of Atman, myself, the true nature of Brahman, which is Ishvara. What is this true nature? This true nature is Aham Brahmasmi, I am Atma Brahma, Tattvamasi, Pragyanam Brahma. These are all called as Mahavakya, because these Mahavakyas reveal the great equation that the Atman is Brahman. It is not that this body is Ishvara. No. As long as I'm identifying with this body, I am not Ishvara. I am merely a jiva in the samsara. But when I inquire into my real nature, that real nature is that Aham Brahmasmi. Brahma Satyam Jagan Mityam Jivo Brahma Iva Naparaha is what Shankaracharya says. Brahman is the Satyam, that is one truth which is always existing. It has no beginning, no end, it is always existing. Brahma Satyam Jagan Mityam. The world around us is always changing, hence it is Mityam. Jivo Brahma Iva Naparaha, Jiva is same as Brahman, identity with Brahman. So this is the Vedantic definition, and it is quite confusing sometimes, and when sometimes the discourse could be boring also if you do not have the foundation. So I will not elaborate on this part. Let us just understand for our sake. It is enough to understand that the ultimate goal of moksha, which means permanent happiness without any sorrow. As long as we are in this cycle of life, birth, death, karma, you do one action, you get results of that action, there is no permanent happiness. Only when you attain freedom, go outside of this cycle of birth and death, cycle of karma, action, consequence cycle, then there can be moksha, which is permanent happiness. For let us keep this ultimate goal in mind. The Brahma Atma Ikya is there, but you can keep it in the back. Now, that is the goal. We have defined the ultimate goal. Two things, permanent happiness, no sorrow, and freedom from the cycle of birth and death. Now then, how to attain it? That is the next question. Because the topic is roadmap after all, right? From our condition at present, which is stage A, we have to attain the final stage, which is moksha, which is stage Z. Let us call it Z. So between A and Z, we have 25 letters, 25 stages, or 30 stages, 100 stages. It could be anything based on individual path. But there are certain road, there are certain landmarks, so to speak, in this journey. And I will highlight these landmarks. So let us start with, again, in the reverse direction. I just defined moksha. I said that this samsara, that is this world, this attachment to this world, this living in the cycle of birth and death, all this happens because of the ignorance about our true nature. Therefore, what is the antidote to ignorance, even in a very conventional sense? For example, I don't know once a particular chapter in physics. So what is the antidote to that? I learn that chapter, I gain the knowledge of that chapter, and that knowledge removes the ignorance. Similarly, we are in this bondage, we are in this cycle of sorrow, you know, because of ignorance about true nature of Brahman, true nature of self, true nature of Ishvara, however you put it. So the solution is to knowledge about this true nature, which is also called as Brahma Jnana, Atma Jnana, Brahma Vidya, so many terms the Upanishads uses. So through Jnanam we attain moksha. The Upanishad says there is no other way than this. Only through Jnanam we attain. As one of the Upanishads says, Brahma Vid Apnoti Param. One who knows Brahman attains the highest, and that highest is moksha. Now, how do we attain this Jnanam? Do we already have? No, would we not have already become free? So, we need a guru. We need a shastra which reveals this knowledge, and that shastra is where? Shruti. The Upanishads, the Mahavakyas in the Upanishads give this knowledge. Otherwise, we don't have any means to attain it. The Upanishad says, Tattvamasi, you are that. You, the Jiva, is that. That is Brahman. This knowledge you cannot gain by any other means. Do we have this knowledge on our own? No. Can we get it by pratyaksha, that is seeing things, hearing things? No. Simply by that, we cannot get it. It is through that revelation of the Veda that we get this. That is what is called a Shastra Pramana. And who does this, gives this Bodhana? That is Guru. Guru gives the bodhana, he gives the teaching to the shishya. So, going to Guru is most important. And this process, there is a process, this process is for jnana sadhana, that is sadhana or the spiritual practice or spiritual path taken to attain atma jnana is called jnana sadhana. And is also called as Shravana Chatushtaya. There is fourfold aspects called Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasa leading to Atma Sakshatkara. Atma Sakshatkara is Atma Jnana. So what is this Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasa? Shravana is hearing. Shravana means hearing, listening. What are we listening? What are we supposed to listen? Listen to the teachings of the Shastras from a qualified guru. One who is Shrotriya Brahmanishta, that is one who is very well versed in the Shastra, but one who has also attained Brahman, who is seated in Brahman, who was accomplished, who knows the truth firsthand. Then he reveals the truth to you. He teaches you Upanishads, he teaches you the Mahavakya, the most important is Mahavakya Upanishad, Mahavakya Upadesha, that is Tattvamasi, Aham Brahmasmi, etc., that Upadesha. Now, ideally, if we are a very competent seeker, if we are a Uttama Adhikari, as they say, the moment the Guru says, Tattvamasi, you are that, your Atma is Brahma, then we should attain knowledge immediately. For example, take the famous example of 10 people, not the 10th person. There are 10 friends who cross a particular river, and after reaching the other shore, they try to count whether all of them have reached. Each person counts the other 9% and thinks, oh no, only 9% have come. Who is the missing person? Each person does the same. Each person says there are only 9%. Who is missing? Who is missing? Then there is one 11th person who is just traveling across the path. He sees this drama happening. He says, okay, don't worry, let me count. This person counts all the 10 people. And he says, oh, foolish people, you were not counting your own self. That is why you are always coming up with the number 9. So the moment he pointed this out, the moment he gave this knowledge, that ignorance was removed and they understood the truth. But however, this happens in the case of Uttamadhikari for Vedanta also. If one is a very highly accomplished, competent seeker, having all the necessary qualities, then that person will immediately, upon hearing that Aham Brahmasmi, Brahmavit Apnoti Param, he attains Atma Sakshatkara, he becomes Brahma. However, most of us, 99.99% of us, it does not happen. Even when we read in books or when we listen to this lecture or any lecture of any Swamiji or any Acharya, that does not happen. Right? This is because it is not that the pramana is not functioning. It is because we are filled with lot of obstacles. Our mind is not Shuddha. It is not purified. So then after Shravana, we need more, that is Manana. Self-introspection. After the teacher gives us the teaching, we have to introspect upon those teachings. We have to intellectually convince ourselves. First, gain intellectual conviction. And that is what Manana achieves. Because we get hundreds of doubts. Because mind is like a monkey. We get hundreds of doubts. So that is what is Manana is. You internalize the teaching. You intellectually attain a conviction first. And then there is Nididhyasa. Basically, once you are intellectually convinced of the teaching that Aham Brahmasmi, then you contemplate upon it. You meditate upon it. Such that this meditation, this contemplation carried over a long period culminates in a direct realization, direct knowledge, Atma Sakshatkara. You directly perceive Atman, you become Atman. It should have happened after Shravana itself, but because our mind is filled with all these obstacles, all these impurities, it is not happening. So that is why Manana Nididhyasa is needed. Then once these obstacles are removed by Manana Nididhyasa, the Atma Sakshatkara immediately happens. What was Paroksha Jnana, that is intellectual knowledge, indirect knowledge, because it becomes Aparoksha Jnana. Direct knowledge, direct experience. I'm not using the term experience because people have this notion that experience means some form of samadhi, some form of spiritual state. But ultimate jnanam is not a spiritual state. It is a realization. It's a direct knowledge itself. And that direct knowledge gives Brahmavit apnoti param. You become liberated even when you are alive. Even when your body will become liberated, that is was called as Jivan Mukti. Liberation even when alive. Now, we discuss the goal, the moksha, and how to attain it through knowledge of the self, Atma Jnana, or the knowledge of Brahman, Brahma Jnana, the same two different terms. And to attain that Jnanam, we have to practice, we have to approach a guru. Then do Shravana Madana Manana Nididhyasa, that is listening to the teaching, intellectual internalizing, internalizing the teaching, intellectual, arriving at intellectual conviction by introspecting, and then Nididhyasa, which is contemplating and meditating on the teaching such that you attain the knowledge of the self, which is liberating. But as I said, there are eligibility criteria to even practice this. Even to approach a guru and then get Upadesha from him. Otherwise, all this Upadesha becomes useless. Right? If we are not ready for any path, forget about spiritual path. Even in a materialistic sense, a first standard kid cannot go and give an MBBS exam, right? He has to first complete his primary school, then secondary school, then high school, then come to the 11th and 12th, or first PU, second PU, and then write CET, then go to medical school, medical college, and then become a doctor. So there are different stages, there are different eligibility criteria. We write CET to enter engineering or medicine, right? Likewise, to even approach a guru and practice to do this jnana sadhana or jnana yoga, which is Shravana Manana Nidhyasa. As I said, we need to first have certain set of eligibility criteria. This is called as sadhana chatushtayam. Moksha, then Atma Jnana, then Shravana Chatushtaya, now sadhana chatushtaya. So the reverse way we are going, right? Sadhana chatushtaya means fourfold competencies, fourfold qualities, eligibilities, criteria needed to be developed for doing jnana sadhana. This is called as sadhana chatushtaya. What are them? Viveka, Vairagya, Shatka Sampati. Shatka Sampati is a group of six qualities, and Mumukshatva. What is Viveka? Viveka is the conviction, discriminatory knowledge between what is real and what is unreal. That we need to have an in conviction in our mind that this world is mithya, that is, this world is unreal in the sense that it is temporary. We are able to perceive it, we are living it in everyday sense, but it is always changing. Therefore, it is not eternal. Therefore, it is not satyam. Satya means that which is always true, that which is always real. That which was real yesterday, which was existing yesterday, which will exist tomorrow without any change. Therefore, nitya anitya vastu viveka. That is how Shankaracharya defines. So viveka, we need to have this firm conviction that Brahman or Ishwara or Brahman alone is real. He alone is always there. The world is temporary. This is called as Viveka, and this is very important because only when we have this conviction, then we will have we will develop the logical consequence of this conviction, which is vairagya. When we have all, as I mentioned in the beginning, all of us want to attain happiness. We are all pursuing happiness. But when we realize that the worldly objects can only give us temporary happiness, because world by definition is temporary in nature, it is transient, it is there today, it is not there tomorrow, then they are unable to give us permanent happiness. Only something which is always there can give us permanent happiness, which is always there. Right? So this conviction of Viveka that Brahman alone is real, Brahman alone is eternal, and this world, we are all, this world is anitya, is temporary. This conviction gives rise to dispassion or vairagya towards worldly pursuit, towards artha and kama, towards pursuing mundane pleasures. Because we realize that mundane materialistic objects cannot give us permanent happiness. Therefore, when this dispassion arises in us, that we turn away from these worldly objects, then we can focus on Brahman. That, and we will develop a burning desire to attain Brahman, attain Ishvara. That burning desire is called as mumukshutvam. Viveka, vairagya, mumukshutvam. Now, to help, how does then the person who has this burning desire to attain Brahman go about? How can he accomplish it? That is what Shatka Sampatti is all about. I won't go into detail, but basically it is about Indriya Nigraha. We have to control our mind and the senses. Whenever we see an ice cream in the shop, we should not run behind it and to eat it. Eating is not an issue, but always doing that means we do not have a control over our sense, control over our desires. We see something, we run behind it. It controls us. We don't control it. So Indriya Nigraha is all about controlling our senses. We have five senses, five Karmendriyas, five Jnanendriyas. Now you can all search this on the internet. You'll get details, all our senses, you know, the touch, the smell, the sight, all these senses. Keeping that in control, then there is Titaksha, which is forbearance, patience. If somebody comes and does wrong to us, we should not get worked up. We should bear it out without vengeance. So these are the qualities to develop. And only when we develop this, then we can focus one-pointedly on Ishvara or Brahman. So these qualities are Sajana Chatushtayam. I have 10 more minutes, right, Bhupalji? 5 or 10 more minutes, I think.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So, first was the ultimate goal, moksha. To attain moksha means we have to attain brahmajnana or knowledge of the self. To attain knowledge of the self, we have to practice Shravana Chatushtaya, Shravana Manana Nididhyasa, by approaching a guru. But to become even eligible for Shravana Chatushtaya, we need to develop this Sadhana Chatushtaya. How do we develop the Sadhana Chatushtaya? To develop Sadhana Chatushtaya means we have to first attain Chitta Shuddhi, means purification of the mind. We have to first purify the mind and train the mind to focus on one thing, that is one-pointed concentration, Ekagra Chitta. When the mind is purified and mind is able to concentrate on one thing, that is when there is Chitta Shuddhi and Ekagra Chitta, then the Viveka, the Vairagya, the Shatka Sampati, that is Indriya Nigraha, Titaksha, etc., and Mumukshutva, all this will come together. Without Chitta Shuddhi, without Ekagra Chitta, none of this will come. So, Chitta Shuddhi and Ekagra Chitta is what enables one to attain Sadhana Chatushtayam with practice. See how everything is connected. So, what does Chitta Shuddhi mean? Purification of the mind means, what are these impurities? Six main impurities are given called as Arishat Vargas, the six passions of the mind. You might be aware of this. Kama, Krodha, Moha, Mada, Matsarya, etc. Kama is attachment, lust, attachment to some objects. Krodha is anger. Mada is pride. Moha is delusion. Matsarya is jealousy. All of our mind, we all are affected by this. Somebody comes and says something wrong to us, we immediately become hurt because our ego becomes hurt, because that is what our pride is, hurt. Or the ice cream example I give, it is all about karma. We like something, we run behind it. Sometimes we have no control over it. That is how this drug problem or alcohol problem happens. We lose control of ourselves, our indriyas, because we become too taken away by our desires. So kama, krodha, matsarya, jealousy. Jealousy is very difficult to get over. So all these are as a child, so many other similar kind of duties are, right? There is varnashrama duties, right? So these are all vishesha dharma, these are all tailor-made for each person. It changes from one person to another. But samanya dharma, the ethics is common to. And then when it comes to ekagra chitta, you practice bhakti. If your mind is emotional in character, if your mind is melted, as they say, when you think about a Bhagavan or any Rupa, it may be Bhagavati as a Devi, Shakti, or as a Guru, or Bhagavan as Shiva, Vishnu, whatever form, and your mind melts, you are able to emotionally connect it with the deity. Then the Bhakti Yoga is for you. Through that mind connection, you perform puja, you perform japa, you perform dhyana. By all these activities, you develop one-pointed concentration. You focus on the deity, on the devata, and develop one-pointed concentration, that is ekagrachitta. Or alternatively, or along with it, you can practice Patanjali Yoga, the Raja Yoga, the asana, pranayama, dhyana, dharana. These are all connected. These are all not individual silos. Everything comes into play. That is for the unmelted minds, those who are not emotional in nature. Then they can do such meditations which do not involve a deity per se, but on abstract entities like a lamp or something. That is also what helps you to develop one-pointed concentration. So the goal is to develop one-pointed concentration. Again, there are many nuances here. I'm not going there. So to sum up all the discussion, what I am saying is very simple. Let me go in the proper way now. We went in the reverse way. Let me go from the beginning now. All of us are living a mundane life. We all have hundreds of desires in our life. We want to earn money, we want to become established in career, we want to name, fame, everything, right? And that is all fine. Attaining artha and kama is also very needed. We cannot simply jump to moksha. So how do we attain it? We attain artha and kama through dharma, through dharmic paths. If I want money, I work hard. I do not steal. I do not go and rob a bank or a temple. Right? So that is what living a dharmic life means. And I do my duties as a father, as a son, as a daughter, as a husband, as a wife, as a teacher, as a student, we do all these duties, Vishesha Dharma, and we lead ethical life, that is Samanya Dharma, and we align ourselves with our Swadharma. What is our true purpose in life? What is meaningful to us? As we are doing this, we avoid adharma, we avoid things prohibited in the Shastras, things prohibited by our Gurus, things which are unethical in nature, things we know in our deepest of the heart, we know that is wrong. We avoid all of them. We lead a dharmic living with ahimsa, satya, etc. by practicing it. In addition to this practice, and we try to practice it in such a way by submitting, surrendering all our actions, the fruit of our action, and even the notion of doership. I am doing this at the feet of Bhagavan. You know, at the end of all puja, we say, Sarvam Shri Krishna Arpanamastu. We do this twice a day. Get up in the morning, pray to Bhagavan, and say that I have let the day be good for me. Let me lead a dharmic life today. And all of that I submit to you, surrender to you. At the end of the day, you again say, I tried to live a dharmic life today, and I am surrendering all of that at your feet. Slowly, this practice will strengthen your conviction. It will give rise to so many things that you can't imagine. I can't tell now. This is a very simple practice. So you do your dharma. You will first avoid adharma, lead a dharmika life, do your special duties as a son, father, student, etc. Do your common duties, that is ethical duties, lead an ethical life, and do all this in a Ishwara Arpana Buddhi by surrendering at the feet of Ishwara. Second, practice bhakti in whatever form. Practice meditation, bhakti, puja, even bhakti is in a different ways. Many ways are there. Even reading a Purana, Brahmana, Itihasa, Purana, Ramayana, Mahabharata, listening these stories, these are also bhakti. Develop connection to your Kuladevata. Develop connection to your Ishta Devata. Practice some form of puja, some japa. Do this. Whatever the spiritual path, it's okay. Do that. So when you do all of them, with time, maybe in this life, maybe in next life, you will reach a stage wherein the purification of the mind will happen. One-pointed concentration will be developed. Then you will slowly develop the viveka, vairagya, etc., the sadhana chatushtaya. When you develop these qualities, then the guru will only come to you when you are ready. It is not necessary that one has to go and search for a guru. That is also there. Many do that, and that is okay. But when one is truly ready, the guru will himself come also. That is also true. That is how the Devata Anugraha is important. That is why the practice of bhakti is important, because the Bhagavan will send you guru. So when that guru appears, surrender to that guru will teach you the ultimate truth, the Mahavakya Upadesha, the Shravana Manana Nididhyasa, the Jnana Yoga will happen then. That will lead to Atmajnana, the ultimate knowledge of the self, the ultimate knowledge of Brahman, which results in moksha or liberation, which is nothing but Brahma Atma Aikya Jnana itself. I hope this was not too boring. I hope this was not too dry. Because of paucity of time, I had to keep it limited to the topic without any meandering with any anecdotes or anything. I recommend you read the book. You can see, I hope, in my background. This is my latest book, Ishavasya Upanishad, an English commentary published last year. The second part of the book deals with what I have just told you in more detail. You can refer it, do reflection upon it, and make some changes to your life as you see fit. And I hope this whole talk was useful to you. Thank you very much, Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. If there are any questions, I am open to take.
Thank you, sir. Your talk was very relevant. And we do have a few questions. Sir, in today's world, where everything is super sophisticated. How do we develop interest to start the journey to attain jnana?
Wonderful question. I think the very question, the way it is framed, and it is how we all of us frame, including myself, we recognize that there is some kind of a breakout between our tradition, our Sanatana way of living, and how we are actually living today, which can be called as modernity, the modern way of life, the contemporary living, the fast-paced living, the rat race, fine. But then that is true. There is a break, there is a change, historical reasons, colonial invasions and everything. I won't go there. But the fact is, though there is that difference, what we truly want does not change. As I spoke in the very beginning of the lecture, all of us want to be happy. Now, if we have this conviction that I want to be happy and I start searching for the means for happiness, then it will easily take us to understand that the worldly objects cannot give us that ultimate happiness. They will give us limited happiness. Yes, and there is nothing wrong in pursuing them per se. I will not say that everyone has to be sannyasi. No, that is meaningless. But there are also more subtle, more better ways of attaining happiness. That is what meaningful life is all about. For example, let me be elaborate. When we pursue artha, what kind of happiness do we derive? For example, a billionaire has 100 very luxurious cars with him. He may not even drive all of them. He's just keeping it. The happiness he's deriving is in the form of a conviction that I am so rich that I have 100 cars. I am so rich that I have $100 million in my account. That's it. He's not even enjoying it because he is running 100 companies. He does not even have time to enjoy them. So this is the kind of happiness a pursuit of artha with single mind pursuit of artha will give you. A single mind pursuit of kama, as we normally understand, the mundane pleasures, will give a different kind of happiness. What is it? I may not have 100 cars, but I am able to buy what I like. I have one car. I love it a lot. I drive it a lot. I derive happiness by driving it. Similarly, I love a person. I'm marrying him or her. I'm living a life with them. I'm happy. I'm enjoying my life. I'm deriving happiness in the form of sensual pleasure. The pleasure of the eyes, the ears, the mind, everything in a day-to-day basis. This is the kind of pleasure you derive by pursuing kama in isolation. But there is also a more subtler and higher form of happiness. What is it? When you pursue dharma, you have a conviction that I am leading a life in sync with dharma, in sync with the Shastric teachings. I am leading ethical life. I am not hurting anybody. I am not making money by cheating or corruption. This kind of happiness is what is called as satisfaction or contentment. You do not get contentment when you are simply at pursuing artha and kama. Only when you connect, join the artha and kama pursuit to dharma pursuit, then through artha and kama, along with that notion of happiness that artha and kama gives, you also will derive the notion of happiness, which is contentment. Whatever I am achieving, even though it is not as rich as 100 cars, I may have simply a bike and not a car, or I may have a Maruti car and not a luxurious car, but still I earned it rightfully and it rightfully belongs to me. I earned it in an ethical way, and this gives me contentment in my life. Without contentment, all happiness is useless. And dharma also gives me one more thing, the satisfaction that I earned punya. And this punya will give me much more happiness, even in terms of artha and kama in future, maybe 20 years down the line or two lives down the line. And punya will, and this dharma will also give me chitta shuddhi, and I may attain moksha in future. So after dharma, then there is another way of pursuing, that is nishkama bhava. I have a conviction that these all these worldly pursuits are useless. I am pursuing that because I am living in this world, because I need to maintain my body. Only then I maintain my body, then I can perform yoga, I can perform sadhana, I can attain moksha. Pertaining moksha, the welfare of the body and mind is needed. So I am pursuing whatever is needed, but I am not attached. I only want Ishvara. I don't need anything else. So that is also gives you happiness. That is also gives you some form of contentment, some form of happiness, knowing the fact that I will be attaining liberation. Because even in Vairagya, there is Raga. When you practice Vairagya, that is dispassion to worldly objects, there is Raga or attachment to Ishvara. It may be in one form or the other. It may be the in the form of a mumukshu pursuing in the pursuit of Nirguna Brahman, or in the form of a bhakta pursuing Krishna or Shiva or Shakti, the Guna Brahman. But that is there. So when we realize that this kind of happiness is there, there is a greater happiness than mere pleasures that we derive from kama and artha, then immediately we start asking questions, what are they? And to know that dharma and nishkama dasha moksha, we have to take refuge in the shastras, in the guru, in Vedanta. Then the things will start on its own. So it doesn't matter we are living in a rat race, fast contemporary 21st, 22nd century, because the fundamental needs of human are same. We all want happiness. We just need to introspect about what this happiness actually is. I hope this answers.
Yes, sir. And another question, how do we develop patience while walking on this path?
I think no answer will be satisfactory and no answer will be easy to implement because I think it's a journey itself rather than this. Life teaches patience sometimes. And sometimes we can strive to attain patience. Bhagavan Shankaracharya says, he defines Titaksha as Sahanam Sarva Dukkhanam Apratikara Purvakam Chinta Vilaparahitam Satitiksha Abhidiyate. So he gives important points to develop this Titaksha or patience of forbearance. What is this? First, Sahanam Sarva Dukkhanam. Whatever Dukkha comes, try to bear with it. But how do we bear with it? Not because we are weak. Not because we have no other scope. He says, apratikara purvakam, without a sense of revenge. Again, not because we are weak that we are unable to take revenge. But we have to develop the strength of the mind that we do not retaliate even when we are able to retaliate. So we first develop the strength. We become strong and then we control our strength. We need to know how, when to use the strength and when not to use the strength. Sahanam sarva dukkhanam apratikara purvakam chinta vilapa rahitam. This is the key here. Chinta vilapa rahitam, without any chinta, without any suffering of the mind, without any, how do we translate chinta? Chinta, in Kannada we say chinte, right? Without any worry in the mind. Normally what happens when something bad happens to us in life, we become frustrated. We want to remove that frustration on somebody. We don't know whom to remove. Even when we know whom to remove, we are not able to, we do not have the power. We are either financially poor or we are hierarchically placed in a lower position. For example, a student may become frustrated against a teacher for wrongly scolding him, but the student cannot do anything. So we can become frustrated, right? But that frustration and inability to do something also says that we are worrying in the mind. We are controlling ourselves not to do anything because we are weak. But there is worry in the mind. We are suffering in the mind. So that is not patience. The true patience of Titaksha is when the things, the bad things happen to you or when you are going through a bad phase, you face it. You try to control your feelings. You try to control your mind, your mental responses. You try to bear with it, with the knowledge that this will also pass. Just as happiness is temporary, even pain is also temporary. This will also pass. You surrender yourself to Bhagavan Ishwara. Whoever is your deity, you surrender to them. Take refuge in them and derive strength from there to bear through it. Do not give in to your initial impulsive responses. When there is need to exhibit strength, you exhibit strength. But you do not exhibit strength now from a point of frustration, but from the point of consciousness, in a conscious. And you try to overcome the sorrow in the mind. So that is what the patience is all about. And this, no amount of lecture will give you patience. Now, my point of deliberating all this is that each one can learn something from it and try to implement. One has to go through it again and again and again. And maybe after trying for many decades, one will attain some form of strength, some form of some form of forbearance, some degree, some magnitude of forbearance. So nothing is easy. Even practicing, I mentioned about ethical tenets, ahimsa, satya, nastyam. None of them is easy. None of them is straightforward. So it is a engagement with these tenets, these dharma, over many lifetimes, not just many decades, many lifetimes. We need to play the long game. Moksha is the long game. The roadmap that I mentioned, 99% of us will not attain it in this life. It's a long game over many, many different lives. And only Ishvara is our refuge. So take refuge in Ishvara, because only He is Karma Faladata. He gives the fruits of action. He is the omniscient Sarvagya. He knows our past and the present and the future. So you take refuge in Him, you are safe. No matter what your situation is, take refuge.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Your talk beautifully summarized on what it means to have a meaningful life, that which you said is a happy life. And on this road to reach our true nature, you definitely gave us many pit stops on where we should start. And your explanation of Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana, they're all the kickstarts so we can reach that Atma Sakshatkara, which was very beautifully summarized in your talk. Above all, you told us on how our gurus important, like the gurus' guidance and blessings are very important. And we are also fortunate to have a guru who is guiding our each and every step. In fact, in our university, we are exposed to learn the Bhagavad Gita, Narada Bhakti Sutras and Upanishads, which just talks about these Vedantic truths in a beautiful manner. And your talk was very relevant and very useful to us. Our gratitude to you, sir. We will now end the session with a prayer.
Sahana vavatu, sahanau punaktu, sahaviryam karavavahai, tejasvinavati tamastuma vidvishavahai. Shanti, shanti. Shanti.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.